reconstruction of Gigantopithecus, but Gigantopithecus has long been considered a sort of a potential ancestor for Sasquatch.
How did you react when you first saw it? I froze. I thought, at first, I thought a person threw a rock at me, but then I saw something take off to the bush and there was no way that was a man.
Size of the track with the amount of weight over one small part of it. A biomechanical foot, and there's anthropology studies and scientific journals that talk about this.
You're looking at, we're about almost 20 kilometers up Harrison Lake, at the 20 mile point actually.
The first thing that convinced me was back in 1970 when I saw and studied a pair of footprint casts from up in the north.
My name is John Green, and I've been studying Sasquatch since 1957.
But if we look at the habitat across British Columbia, there are vast areas with very little human population that almost certainly harbor Sasquatch.
To your right, my left, Grover Krantz, again for our viewers, a professor of anthropology at Washington State University, author on this subject. What, tell our viewers, what has convinced you that yes, there is a Bigfoot?
Well, the first thing that convinced me was back in 1970 when I saw and studied a pair of footprint casts from up in the northeastern corner of Washington. And this is one we refer to now as cripple foot. The right foot was badly crippled, and I tried to reconstruct the likely bone structure. And at the time, I didn't think it was very likely real. But when I reconstructed it, I found out it was exactly the kind of design that would be necessary for an 8-foot-tall creature with an otherwise human body design. And I figured nobody could have figured this out.
And this, you say, it's the casts that have convinced you?
Yes. Not just that they are casts, but in some of them I can see some details of anatomy that I figured nobody else could have plotted from nothing. And I see them in the footprints, and I figure if somebody faked those, he had to know more about human anatomy than I do, and a more inventive mind than mine, and I don't think there is anybody like that.
Bosberg Cripplefoot. It still remains one of the most interesting, I think, one of the most interesting cases. So here's a pair of tracks that were cast in Bosberg, Washington, up near the Canadian border, in northeastern Washington state. This foot's quite normal, a normal, healthy Sasquatch, let's put it that way. But this one shows some remarkable pathologies to it. It was either the result of a crushing injury in adulthood, or it could have been neuropathy, a spinal cord lesion, say, that caused damage down the nerves to the distal features and then cause the tissue, soft tissues, to pull the foot into a contorted posture. You can see the toes are pushed out of alignment, bent off at odd angles. The third toe's probably just simply pushed up out of alignment with the other toes so that it doesn't leave an imprint. But really telling here are these two bulges on this side. Now the position of these bulges in a modern human would be way back here on a foot of this length, because we have a disproportionately shorter calcaneus, the greatly elongated calcaneus for greater leverage, massive weight, corresponding to the massive weight of this creature, displaces these landmarks more distally or further down the foot. The possibility, or the probability, let's put it that way, the probability that a hoaxer would stumble on a representation of this pathology, which to an orthopedic surgeon or a podiatrist seems quite natural. For someone to have, in 1972 especially, to have concocted something that was so convincing and to have incorporated this particular pathology in a divergent location or an anomalous, let's put it that way, an anomalous location vis-a-vis a human foot, but in precisely the right place for it to correspond with the position of that joint in other examples of midfoot flexibility, it defies imagination.